everybody, and welcome to Alphabet Soup. Just a reminder to keep your cell phones off. However, you're totally welcome to record and videotape. We have a lot of stars lined up for y'all. We also encourage you to sing along and dance along. You're gonna hear some of really popular and incredible numbers, and our performers love it when people sing along and engage. So buckle up, sit tight, and have a great time.
Everyone else in the room can see. They say flowers don't bloom on the grave of heterosexuality because love dies through ye. They say queerness is perversion, hopelessly disgusting and shamelessly defiant. Bigots just know, for sure, that our hearts don't have the capacity to be for anything but lust. This they hold to be fact, that queer love cannot feel like anything of importance. But they're wrong. Tell me, what could they possibly know? What do they know about the feeling that ensues after getting lost in a haze of hazel eyes, my soul simply turning into putty in your hands? Your footstep has gotten latched onto the pieces of me I didn't want to be known, but now have been pulled to the surface. What do they know about the moment our heartstrings are gently restored in Fleetwood? When someone's name is carved onto your tongue so you whisper it every 10 seconds. They find antipathy in the most ethereal of things when I'm softly whispering under my breath saying, you were the first person to hold my hand and make it mean something, to take away my breath and I don't ask for it back. They can't see into our heads when we spot someone who's taken our broken hearts hostage, recalling memories of friendships and inside jokes, this failed understanding as to why something as simple as moves spelled backwards can mean absolutely anything to me. They wouldn't get the creativity behind queer love or Elton John lyrics when he says, yours are the sweetest eyes I've ever seen. There's a complex delicacy to queer love that distasteful words and living and dead languages cannot encapsulate, even when I try to say the words, tu es ma lune, et je pense à toi, tu es lune. Tu es mon cher, mon ange, mon diable, mon corps est le tien, et je rêve de toi. You are my moon, and I think of you every night. You are my darling, my angel, my devil. My heart is yours, and I dream of you. Those who are hateful can say those words and actually mean them. Queer people within ourselves are undefined bouts of beauty and unstable meanings. We are deconstructed cliches, multidimensional layers of actual love stuffed in bursting supernovas. We are beyond what people perceive love to be, never been your Romeo and Juliet. We are not expectation. We do not fit in. I do not. I've never wished for bouquets of overgrown roses, but instead, personalized well-sharp jokes, cacophonies of memories I can take with me to bed each night, things that mold my patheticism into euphoria and ecstasy. Our ability to love is a national anthem, a callback to originality, a creation of unerasable history. We are ancient castles never to be destroyed, even if you get to witness our ruins after being broken down by years of horror and hellfire. Yes, sometimes we're in shards, but we always piece each other back together again until we're permanent remnants of, what was it? A rainbow? Yes, I think that was it.
Thank you. do a Rebecca Sugar number by the name of Love Like You, featured on a hit show, Steven Universe.
Give it up for the band.
My brain isn't sick, but I'll tell you my skin.
amazing songwriter.
Writers are actually really cool.
Yeah, I kind of miss creative writing sometimes.
We miss you so much. Please come back.
No.
Worth a shot.
I mean, we do have some amazing writers in theater too, you know.
That reminds me. Please welcome writer Tyrion with his original piece, The Time Has Come For It to Stop.
Time has come for it to stop. The beats and the pumps, the inhales and the sighs, the zips and the zaps, the shakes and the swivels. It's a comfortable space, the space I always feel the need to return to. It's nice to feel the weight of gravity pulling in my chest. It's nice to feel the weight of thought pulsing in my head again. The magnetization of questions and hugs, the low tone responses, the fake smile that weighs more than you've ever known. The feelings of nothing. The feeling of everything. It's so hard to push out, to break through the brick and the concrete with only your bare hands, but you do it every single time. Layering yourself in even more dust and debris, lodging more shards of stone and gravel deeper into your knuckles. And then you come crawling back to feel the same thing you've already felt many times over. You're hoping it's even more violent and vengeful this time. You hope that this time is the last. That this time it builds so high that every soul sees its final fall. It's so simple. Waking up late, not doing anything productive other than the bare minimum, not caring about other people, not caring about you. Letting the wind slowly drag you across the floor, letting the stream try to wear you down, but you cannot be worn down any longer because you haven't hit rock bottom. You are rock bottom. The only thing that can and will get you out is you. You're waiting for someone to light a fire under your ass or ignite that bombshell in your brain, but it's never going to happen and it's never going to be enough. I understand that it's hard to be limited in strength and thought, but soon you'll realize that all you're doing is wasting away and letting the sands of time fill your insides. And soon, you'll be left laying at 3 a.m. in your closet on 365 and 1/4 days of the year. So pick yourself up. Pick yourself up until you can't pick yourself up any higher. And find someone that cares. That really, truly cares. That you feel like is the one because they're the first ones to understand. And the first ones to really listen. And if they truly care, they'll pick you up without even asking. And one day, you'll find yourself with 4 other people that make you feel whole for once in your life. And make you figure out who you truly are. And even if they don't last, even if you're left with that one person, it doesn't matter. Because that first person has promised to be with you forever, and you know they will. And you can't wait till forever comes. Thank you.
Writer so much.
Right, I mean, I felt that in my heart and soul.
It just makes me think of, like, how much I love the space that the PBA community has cultivated for people of all backgrounds.
You know, speaking of love and space, we've actually got Chloe Vong doing an out-of-this-world rendition of Fly Me to the Moon by Frank Sinatra coming up next.
Ooh.
Let me play among the stars.
what's such a beautiful thing being up here on the stage celebrating queer people and queer culture in our community.
Right? When I was younger, I couldn't even begin to imagine like being part of or let alone hosting something like this.
Yeah, man, all this talk about our childhood is making me kind of nostalgic. Give it up for Miguel Ralph. I'm throwing his original spoken word piece by the little girl.
Understood that I am not who I said I was, and although I have embraced my newfound identity, there's still a very present part of me that mourns the little girl I was and the woman I could have become. There's a part of me that mourns the little girl who would wear flowery dresses and stumble in her mother's high heels, the little girl who would run in the grass, her pink raincoat fluttering around her, the little girl who traded Pokemon cards during recess, built teeny snowmen in a park she'd never see again, the little girl who would cry in purple bedsheets because she did not want to be a little girl at all, the woman who would call her girlfriends with the latest gossip, giggling about some guy, the woman who would order pizza and watch cheesy rom-coms simply because she was sad, the woman who would share looks with the stranger at her right, because both of them knew what it was like to not be a man. The woman who would crawl into herself with the thought that she was a woman after all. But I'm not that little girl, and I am not that woman. Yet they both hug my mother's heart as she mourns them too, the deep grooves in her under eyes a testament to her longing. They rub soothing circles around my father's back, whispering to him that in some ways I am still his oldest daughter. I carry them, the little girl and the woman inside me, hold them close so they will not fly away like the summer breeze fading to winter. And all three of us look up and enjoy the autumn sky.
Me pregunto si tengo muchas novias, hoy tengo a una, mañana a otra, ey, pero no hay boda, Titi me pregunto si tengo muchas novias, hoy tengo a una, mañana a otra, me las voy a llevar a todas con VIP. Me gusta mucho la Gabriela, la Patricia, la Nicole, la Sofía. Mi primera novia en Kinder María y mi primer amor se llamaba Talía. Tengo una colombiana que me escribe todos los días y una mexicana que ni yo sabía. Otra en San Antonio que me quiere todavía y la TPR que todas son mías. Una dominicana que juega bombón, juega bombón. La de Barcelona que vino en avión y dice que mi bicho está cabrón. Yo dejo que jueguen con mi corazón. Quisiera mudarme con todas por la mansión. El día que me case te envío la invitación. Muchacho, deja eso. Ey, Titi me preguntó si tengo muchas novias. Muchas novias. Hoy tengo una, mañana otra. Ey, pero no hay boda. Titi me preguntó si tengo muchas novias. Ey, ey, muchas novias. Hoy tengo una, mañana otra. Titi me preguntó.
¿Para qué tú quieres tanta novia?
y'all have been wonderful so far. Again, I'm Elijah Islam.
I'm Irene Roddy.
I'm Jupiter Zimmerman Yang.
I'm Astrid Allen.
Guys, don't freak out. Fiona's gone.
What?
Oh, no.
Wait, that's so weird.
Wait. I think I remember her mentioning something about a comedy act.
Oh, yes, I remember that too. So everyone, let's give it up for PBA's second ever comedy act in the diversity series, our very own Fiona Clayton. Thank you.
me it is. This is like everything to me. And I'm thinking to myself, well, I gotta tell her. You know, I gotta tell her that I think she's really beautiful, whatever. What's a better time to do that than right as you're getting off the bus? And you know, if anybody in here knows anything about an HISD bus, that thing is usually running about 45 minutes late. Right, so I'm like, I got time. I can plan this out. But today was an early day. We get there about 15 minutes early, and I realize right then, you know, you can't back out. You're a winner. I win. I work hard, and I win! So I get in the aisle. She's kind of like, we'll get her phone. Got my bag on. I have like a really old man look on my face. And I'm gonna say something, I'm gonna open my mouth to do it, and nothing. And she just looks up at me, and I've never seen a woman look more disgusted at the fact that I'm alive. It's just the fact that I'm here. It's not for her.
Have you been on a first date?
Yeah.
You can make
honest answer. Raise your hand if you want to give me like an honest, painful answer. How are you today?
I'm so tired. Y'all, I'm so tired.
Why'd you come to the matinee? Why'd you come to the matinee if you're that tired?
So I came here because I was supposed to have a date, right? I was supposed to have a man here. Mama's boy got sick.
You don't get sick at 1:30.
Right. If you're sick, it's of something, not on your own accord. Guys, how is anyone else doing? I'm a little curious. You're good? Are you lying?
No.
You delayed. You delayed there.
Yeah. I mean, we just graduated on mom last year.
Put my phone number on the list so you can call me.
With the cat eye glasses?
Yeah. Little Miss 1950?
You said over 55? Are you lying to me? You sure?
Yes.
You sure? Are you lying to me?
No.
Okay, Eddie. Does anyone see Mama Mia? Can I get a... You were... Yeah. What'd y'all think of Mama Mia? Are y'all just saying that because I was in it, or did you not recognize me? Raise your hand if you didn't realize I was in Mama Mia. Thank you for your honesty. I was the sexy bartender.
I'm so glad I'm not a musical person.
Why aren't you?
Do you think I want to see another like movie remake or something new? I don't want to see Legally Blonde. Dated too many blonde girls.
That's crazy.
Yeah, I know, it's just bad.
Last girl I dated.
A girl?
Last girl I dated. His name is Caesar now. So I can't seem to get with women, ever, apparently. You know what? It's for the better, though. It's for the better.
This is not good. Like, y'all, can you stand up?
Please, stretch your legs, if you're able to. If the hip replacement wasn't too brutal, that wasn't to call out, I wasn't. I know yours wasn't. You're still on that singular sensation, every little step she takes. A thrilling combination, every move that she makes.
Oh, I see a Violent Femmes shirt. You like Violent Femmes? Did you see them?
Yeah. Oh, I didn't see
them. Oh, you didn't see them? You like them?
Yeah.
Yeah, you should see them.
Has anyone in here ever worn a band t-shirt and not known what the band was? Go home!
Get out!
What was the band? Was it Nirvana? Was it Nirvana?
I just borrowed my mom's band shirt.
Why does your mom own band shirts if you don't know the music? Is that really your mom? If your mom hasn't forced her music taste on you,
that would be my dad.
Either your mom has bad music taste and knows it.
Whoa. Oh, no, wait, my dad.
No, wait, what's your defense? What's your defense, Miss Julia?
That I
okay, but why haven't you forced it on your kids yet?
Yeah. Then it doesn't apply to you! We work together. Why are you here?
With a friend.
Okay, wow.
Last year, Robin?
No, we worked with, I was a camp counselor. Can you believe that?
Oh. Camp counselor.
You know, like she was working with an O, I was working with an E. So, yeah.
Question, what's the gayest ice cream place? Yes, who said Ben and Jerry's? Is that you? Irene, I love you. Say hi to Irene. I didn't hear everyone say hi to Irene. You're all liars. Say hi to Irene.
Hi, Irene.
Good job. You're doing better.
Talk to them. Hi, guys. This is an intermission, so if you're like, we're not holding you hostage here. Like, if you have to pee, like, go pee. We'd rather not.
Go piss off.
Hi, Meg.
Hi, Irene.
How are you doing today?
I'm good. I'm fabulous.
How are the middle schoolers?
Some of them are annoying, but a lot of them are really cool. Really nice.
That's awesome. I'm not funny.
your job?
Come on, Mom. Tell them.
I think you just said it.
I drink wine for a living.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't even drink, and I commend that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, all day.
You said that's your mom?
That's my mom.
And she drinks wine for a living?
Yeah.
Did she start working before or after she had you?
You know, I might look it, but it was before and after.
I would only be surprised if it was before. I would understand after. I'm kidding, I love you.
All right, are we ready to...
Has it been 5 minutes? Yeah. All right, we're gonna wrap it up because y'all are giving corpse, and not in the husband way. Only a few people understood that. That's upsetting.
Oh, wow.
Only a few people understood where they are.
Where is the rest of them? Come hither. Come here.
Welcome back, TVA.
Your mic's not on.
That mic is on.
Okay.
That was really chaotic, but... We love you guys! The entire process of the show has been chaotic.
Yeah.
But we're so excited for you to see all of our other acts.
Yeah, and I think it's time that we get just a little bit more instrumental representation on stage.
I agree. So let's all give it up for Maggie Usher singing Blood and Fire by the Indigo Girls.
Call me back.
Started in the atmosphere.
awe-inspiring. I'm running out of words.
It was just so moving.
You know what else can be really moving? A good extended metaphor.
So you're definitely a creative writer. Moving on from that, our next performance is going to blow you off the face of the planet.
Or it actually might keep you stuck to the face of the planet.
We have Eleanor Nelson singing As the World Caves In.
Thank you.
piece to share with us tonight. The Owl. Give it up for Irene! Woo! Hoisted atop a church that rests at the peak of the Orange Prairie Hill. As he sits around and woefully watches the school children lace up their Converse All-Stars, his barber shapes his wings into a wildly obnoxious leprechaun shape. But the owl pays no mind, crossing his legs as his feathers fall into the altars below. To the left of this church is an archery range. The librarian tosses the books into the sky, and the paralyzed man pierces them back to the ground. But it wasn't always like this. A long time ago, the owl from the church braided hair and taught history, but the owl has since retired from his headmaster days and resorts himself to watching the kids and the arrows in the dying pumpkin patch that lays to rest at the bottom of his hill. The car the owl drove used to be 2.5 feet off the ground. It was blue, had many cup holders, sailed his wife over the Gulf of Mexico, boldly loved Tulsa, Oklahoma, and most importantly brought him and his daughter to school every single morning. The road to the school had a tree that looked like an elephant, and sometimes there were buses that held up the traffic, and little kids would often stare out the back windows at the cars trailing them, occasionally waving lunchboxes or throwing apple seeds, their eyes wild with amusement that there were other people in the world grander than their innocent glow. The pumpkin patch for a long time was a place of solidarity. The owl jumped and hopscotched through its winding path, vines and dirt leaked through the pink puffer jackets sprawled out on the golden speckled floor. Cactus spikes poking out of its seams, warning you to stay away. A grandmother waves softly from a distance, but as she slowly inches her way toward the jacket, one foot in front of the other, the spikes lax themselves out, retreating back into the fleece comfort. At the center of the pumpkin patch is a circular pony ride. Shaped like a spider, it spins round and round all day for the little children that go to school just up the hill. And sometimes the owl will go and perch himself in the vertex of this apparatus. Brown ponies didn't know his name, but the black ones were well familiar with the owl, and their dance always calmed him. He long wished he knew someone to share in his calmness, as his daughter was much too bold for the pumpkin patch's dainty embellishments. The corn maze of which the owl adored filled with green leaves and purple castles, and rats didn't dare enter, as the owl might have used their tails as a fishing pole, but he cared not if the rats feasted up from underneath the pumpkins as long as they feasted up from below. The owl was an avid academic, but he studied not the rules of English or the fluidity of Spanish. He often found himself studying the ways of the people around him. If there was a baby screaming ahead in the distance or a grandparent coughing out a last breath, he had rotated his head in the direction of the alarm and matched his eyes to meet the sound. And when he were to witness death, he would abandon his perch atop the church on the hill, pick up some flowers from the pumpkin patch, and fly down to pay his respects. But the most important thing to note about this owl, of which I have lectured you for the past 2 pages, that he loved more than anyone else. The owl would leave a place shinier than he had found it, enabling all the people who stood around to hear him speak to take the high road in all that they did. However good the owl was, he was still met with undetermined challenges. A man with a perm tried to sell his pumpkin patch for a big mansion in West University on the north side of the tracks. And the owl just smiled and asked the curly man if he felt fulfillment taking away the peacefulness of a child's education on the wake of a tragedy. But in response, the man with the perm just twiddled his thumbs, spinning them over each other, and called his contractor. It's an odd thing the way that people treated the owl. You would think at some point the owl would no longer be able to withstand the asteroids thrown at him when he has always shown nothing but kindness. But that's what makes the owl wonderful. The owl, despite all who wronged him, took a deep breath and tickled the clouds, recentering his claws on his wooden perch, and continued with class and love. Due to this, he took his solace in that of which he felt passionate. The single lined notes of a guitar and the primary colors that make up a comic strip. The owl was nothing if not altogether loving and artistic. I came across this owl when I was walking down that little road, the one with the tree that looked like an elephant, and I had just left the small corner store, a cosmic brownie in one hand and a root beer in the other. And I turned up the corner into his small hill, and that's where I found him, gently listening to all the world around him. And what's funny about what happened next is also what happened to spark this story. He took me by the hand and walked me down to his pumpkin patch, a little odd for a bird with the widest wingspan and sharpest talons,
easy to latch on and take me away. But still I let him guide me back down the hill, and without as much of a mutter, he sat me down on his pumpkins and had his horses dance for me. Thank you. Hey, guys, the B-reel went off. Can y'all be my B-reel?
Represented in shows like these.
Yeah, representation? You know, that kind of sounds like the whole point of the diversity series.
Oh my god. Oh. Well, you know what? It makes me really proud, and it makes me really excited to like see all these wonderful people doing their thing and performing.
Yes.
You should just say it. Irene's like, but you should say it.
Okay. Speaking of wonderful, performance coming up. I think it's not more spoken word, is it?
Well, no, it has words, but instead of spoken, it's sung by the amazing Courtland Barrett and Adele Cameron.
Show is like 16. That kind of reminds me of the past.
pleasant 16?
No.
It's sweet 16. Oh, Toby and Mikey are doing that one right.
Yes, right you are. Now let's give it up for Toby and Mikey performing Sweet 16 by Daisy and the Scouts.
Thank you.
work and dedication.
Guys, I don't want to be like very bad news or anything, but I think we lost one of our leaders.
What do you mean? Is it Eli?
Where's Eli?
Oh, wait, he's probably doing like college apps or something. I mean, like, Tulane's deadline coming up, you know?
No, wait, don't you remember? Eli has an app.
Oh, wait, yeah, you are right, dude. It's some third vision viewer.
No, I think you're right, yeah.
No, guys, it's called Second Sight Seer by Will Wood and the Tapeworms, performed by your very own Eli.
Thank you so much for coming out. No, it's another hand. And also, thank you especially to Tech
band. Give it up for her.
And Alice. Everybody say thank you, Alice.
Thank you, Alice.
So, yeah, thank everyone. Thank all of y'all, especially the audience, especially everyone that's helped us. Thank you so much for coming. You're all amazing, and you've all made the show really what it is.
Are we closing out?
Yeah, I think we are. So, all right, everyone, thank you for coming.
Stay safe.
Stay cool.